of tomorrow. If you'd like to know, this video is for you. Hi, it's Roger Hamilton with another episode of Entrepreneur TV, where I'm going to give you three different visions of the future, and you get to decide which one you think we're most likely to be heading towards. And stay right to the end when I'm going to give you three steps for you to take to future-proof and future-protect yourself, regardless of which way things go. So first of all, something about each of these books. You may have read about Harari's book Sapiens, which sold over 12 million copies and has been recommended by everyone from Bill Gates to Barack Obama. His follow-up book to that is this book here, Homo Deus, A Brief History of Tomorrow, which he wrote in the year 2016. And it gives an optimistic but also frightening view of the future as human 2.0, when we end up merging man with machine. And if you think that's fanciful thinking, have a look at this tweet by Elon Musk just from this week, where he says AI symbiosis while you wait. He's referring to his company Neuralink, which has got a big announcement coming on the 28th of August. And if you're wondering what that announcement's gonna be, here is an article which gives you a taster. A monkey has been able to control a computer with his brain, CEO Musk says of his startup's brain-machine interface. Ultimately, we can do a full brain-machine interface where we can achieve a sort of symbiosis with AI. We hope to have this aspirationally in a human patient by the end of this year. So did George Orwell see this coming? He wrote his book, 1984, in the year 1948. That was over half a century ago, and he was predicting that there would be a big brother that would end up watching us 24/7. Now, you would have seen all sorts of stories recently about the police state, about mass surveillance, about facial recognition. So we're gonna just see how close we are to that vision today. As for Aldous Huxley's book, A Brave New World, this is almost the opposite of 1984. And he wrote this book even further back. He wrote it in 1931, which was just at the beginning of the Great Depression. And he was predicting mass hypnosis, sleep learning, and having the masses distracted by entertainment and by their desires in such a way they wouldn't even notice that they were being controlled. Some commentators think that that's the world that we have been moving towards. And so let's have a look at the comparison of these two books side by side. Here's a brilliant comic strip that was put together over a decade ago, which is all about Huxley versus Orwell. And this book was in the words of Stuart Macmillan, who wrote a book in 1985, 1 year after 1984. That book was called Amusing Ourselves to Death. A Brave New World versus 1984. What Orwell feared were those who would ban books. What Huxley feared was that there would be no reason to ban books, for there would be no one who would want to read one. Orwell feared those who would deprive us of information. Huxley feared those who would give us so much that we would be reduced to passivity and egotism. Orwell feared the truth would be concealed from us. Huxley feared the truth would be drowned in a sea of irrelevance. Orwell feared we would become a captive culture. Huxley feared we would become a trivial culture. In 1984, people are controlled by inflicting pain. In Brave New World, people are controlled by inflicting pleasure. In short, Orwell feared that what we hate will ruin us. Huxley feared that what we love will ruin us. So who got it more right, and what should we be fearing today? So first of all, many argue, in fact, both exist today, just in different countries. At one extreme, America looks like Brave New World, and on the other extreme, China looks like 1984. If you're not sure if you agree or not, here's some articles to help you decide. So first, let's look at China. George Orwell's star in 1984 is a party member called Winston Smith. He lives in a world where Big Brother is watching over him and where the thought police are arresting people for thought crimes. Telescreens watch us 24/7. Newspeak dumbs down our thinking. And memory holes delete inconvenient histories. The Ministry of Truth oversees propaganda. The Ministry of Love oversees torture. And the Ministry of Peace oversees war. So here's two articles from China this week. China's great firewall of censorship is already going up around Hong Kong. On Tuesday, the government in Hong Kong was granted sweeping powers to censor, block, and erase online content while secretly tracking your digital footprint. Facebook, Google, Microsoft, Twitter, WhatsApp, and Zoom have all said they will stop complying with government orders to hand over data. And that's exactly what Beijing wanted. All are going to be banned. As for surveillance, China's surveillance technology is keeping tabs on populations around the world. This focus on exportable defense-based AI systems encompasses typical security functions such as mass surveillance and facial recognition, but has grown to include an integrated joint operations platform that uses big data and artificial intelligence to conduct predictive policing. Okay, and now for America. Aldous Huxley named his book after a scene in Shakespeare's The Tempest, where the speaker's innocence blinds her from the true evil of the island. Oh wonder, how many godly creatures are there here? How beauteous mankind is, O brave new world, that has such people in it. The star of his book is a sleep learning specialist called Bernard Marx. And he is experiencing a future where everyone are slaves to their desire, distracted by the pleasures of an attention economy. And in the book, they've even got a new religion, which is called Fordism. Our Lord has turned to Al Ford, where the new God is a combination of Henry Ford and Sigmund Freud, where the base desires of materialism and sex is only exceeded by our use of recreational drugs. And while the citizens are living in blissful distraction, the state is collecting data on every step of their way. So do these stories match up? Here's an article from the New York Times this week. In shadow of pandemic, US drug overdose deaths resurge to record. 72,000 Americans died from drug overdoses last year. It looks as if 2020 will be even worse. Drug deaths have risen an average of 13% so far this year over last year. Add to that the 88,000 who die from alcohol each year, and that's already 150,000 deaths. That's over 400 every single day. And today, over 131 million adults, which is 2 out of every 3 adults, is on some kind of prescription drug. And an article from the Washington Post, the coronavirus pandemic is pushing America into a mental health crisis. Anxiety and depression are rising. The US is ill-prepared, with some clinics already on the brink of collapse. Federal agencies and experts warn that a historic wave of mental health problems is approaching. Depression, substance abuse, post-traumatic stress disorder, and suicide. A federal emergency hotline for people in emotional distress registered a more than 1,000% increase in April compared with the same time last year. Last month, roughly 20,000 people texted that hotline. So yes, there's lots of evidence to show that China is at one level of extreme, which is all about repression from control, and America is a country which has excess out of control. But wait, what if we were to look at the flip side? Could it be that the opposite is also happening? Here's an equally Orwellian story coming out of America right now. This month, Palantir, a US company, said it's filing for its IPO. Palantir was set up by Peter Thiel. Peter Thiel was the co-owner of PayPal with Elon Musk, and he's also the first investor in Facebook. He's grown Palantir into a $20 billion business. And if you haven't heard of them before, you wouldn't be alone, because they're one of the most secretive companies in America. Founded in 2004 with funding from the CIA's not-for-profit venture capital arm in Qtel, Palantir is named for a collection of mystical orbs in Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings that can see both the past and present and allow users to communicate over vast distances. That's not exactly far afield from how Palantir itself operates. Palantir Gotham is a bespoke option used by companies, government agencies, and law enforcement to combine information, surveillance information, on individuals. Here's an article on Palantir's CEO, Alex Karp. Palantir has helped the Los Angeles Police Department analyze data ranging from license plate photos to rap sheets, traffic tickets, listings of foreclosed properties, and more. We take what amounts to strong but often controversial positions. Palantir's technology is used on occasion to kill people. If you've looked for a terrorist in the world, now you're probably using our government product, and you're probably doing the operation that actually takes out the person in another product we built, he said, most likely referring to both Gotham and Foundry, the two products that were created within Palantir. Do you remember the movie Minority Report, which was about the future world in which Tom Cruise is an LAPD policeman working in the pre-crimes unit? Palantir is Minority Report come true. So yes, there's plenty of evidence showing that the surveillance state in the US is as strong as it is in China. And what about China? Are they also creating a distraction economy? Today, the most valuable private company in the world is a company called ByteDance. ByteDance, TikTok's parent company, now worth over $100 billion. ByteDance has significantly risen to become a popular social platform in recent years, boosted in part by a TikTok short video app that has taken most teenagers around the world by storm. So for all of the apps that are turning us into a distraction economy, it's actually China that's now leading the US in using AI to hook us to the very latest in music, dance, or video memes. So the reality is, there is lots of evidence on both sides that both of these visions of the future exist today, not just in America and China, but in countries all over the world. So how can we navigate between these two dystopias, and is there a third way? So in Harari's book, Homo Deus, he talks about what happens when we ourselves become the gods. And that happens when we start to transcend the three biggest epic problems that all humanity has faced, which is famine, plague, and war. And clearly in 2020, with all the crises we're experiencing, we're not out of the woods on those three yet. But Harari does believe that with technology, we're going to be pursuing the kind of brave new world that Huxley talks about by looking even further into how we can live longer, looking further into how we can be happier, and especially on drugs. This is what he has to say about drugs. The biochemical pursuit of happiness is also the number one cause of crime in the world. In 2009, half of the inmates in US federal prisons got there because of drugs. 55% of inmates in UK prisons reported their crimes were linked to using or trading drugs. The rest of the book goes into how we go beyond drugs to enhance human 2.0. And he sees that this is going to come from three paths: biological engineering, cyborg engineering, or engineering of non-organic beings. Or another way to say that is biotech, robotics, and artificial intelligence. So this could lead to an even worse dystopia where we end up with technology running amok. So what's the solution? Harari says that we have to slow things down, which is almost impossible, but then he makes an uncanny prediction. He writes, "When people realize how fast we are rushing towards the great unknown, their reaction is to hope that somebody will hit the brakes and slow us down. But we cannot hit the brakes for several reasons. First, nobody knows where the brakes are. While some experts are familiar with developments in one field, such as artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, big data, or genetics, no one is an expert at everything. Second, if we somehow succeed in hitting the brakes, our economy will collapse along with our society. The modern economy needs constant growth in order to survive. If growth ever stops, the economy won't settle down to some cozy equilibrium. It will fall to pieces." Well, this has now happened for reasons that Harari wasn't even predicting. The economy has stopped and now it is collapsing. But the world keeps turning, so maybe this is our one chance we have to just slow down and say, is this where we want to be going? And this brings me to Harari's latest book, which is called 21 Lessons for the 21st Century. And in this book, he talks about the difference of truth and post-truth. If you feel overwhelmed and confused by the global predicament, you are on the right track. Global processes have become too complicated for any single person to understand. How then can you know the truth about the world and avoid falling victim to propaganda and misinformation? We are living in a new and frightening era of post-truth, and that lies and fictions are all around us. So how can we stay on the razor's edge of sanity and truth without falling on the slippery slope to either side? Here's three steps that I highly recommend that you take. And to give you a background to these three steps, let me first of all tell you a little about me. Some of you know me, some of you don't. I've got a Scottish father, I've got a Chinese mother, I was born in Hong Kong, and I've lived in over 50 countries around the world. Over the last 20 years, I've built my company Genius Group to provide education to entrepreneurs all over the world, where we've got over 1 million entrepreneurs that are learning how to be self-sufficient, where they don't have to get a job because they've learned how to create their own job. And I'm a futurist as well as an entrepreneur, just like the likes of Elon Musk and Richard Branson, because the best way to predict the future is to create it. And this leads me to step number one, which is self-education. Huxley and Orwell actually knew each other, and the fact they had opposing views. In fact, there's a letter which Huxley wrote to Orwell saying, "Within the next generation, I believe that the world's rulers will discover that infant conditioning and narco-hypnosis are more efficient as instruments of government than clubs and prisons, and that the lust for power can be just as completely satisfied by suggesting people into loving their servitude as by flogging and kicking them into obedience." The educator Ken Robinson, who's had more views on his TED Talks than any other person who's done TED Talks, calls this anesthetic learning. Anesthetic in like how our current education system actually puts children to sleep through the way that they're learning. And anesthetic also as the opposite of aesthetic, where aesthetic is about self-expression, it's about living life to the fully, whereas anesthetic is the total opposite of that. So self-education isn't about educating about truth, which is relative anyway, it's about educating yourself on your truth. What is true for you is likely to be very different from what is true for others. The Japanese have a concept for this, which is called ikigai. Your ikigai is your personal truth. It translates into your reason for being. And it's a combination of what you love, which is your passions, what the world needs, which is your purpose, what you're great at, which is your talents, and what you get paid for, which is your vocation. With Genius School, we're redesigning education so that it starts with self-awareness and then moves to self-mastery and self-expression. Finding your truth is not easy, but it is the most essential thing to do today to give you a true north to the path that you choose to take through life. The second step is positive skepticism. Be skeptical about everything that you see and hear. but not so much that you become overwhelmed, miserable, or paralyzed. Positive skepticism is being able to be both skeptical and positive at the same time. All three dystopias are actually existing today. 1984, too much repression. Brave New World, too much distraction. And Homo Deus, too much hubris, where we actually believe that we've become the gods. So the wisest path is the one that every ancient philosophy already identifies as the middle way. From Plato, let him know how to choose the mean and avoid the extremes on either side, for this is the way of happiness. From the Chinese Tao, don't go in and hide, don't come out and shine, stand stock still in the middle. The Bible talks about walking the path of righteousness in the midst of the paths of judgment. The Quran talks about the middle path of moderation. And Confucianism talks about Zhongyang, which is the doctrine of the mean. It's not a coincidence that the mean, which is the middle path, is where we get meaning. And from the Buddhist middle path, there is addiction to indulgence of sense pleasures, which is low, coarse, the way of ordinary people, unworthy and unprofitable. And there's addiction to self-mortification, which is painful, unworthy, and unprofitable. Avoiding both these extremes, the Buddha has realized the middle path. It gives vision, gives knowledge, and leads to calm, to insight, to enlightenment. And what is the middle path? The Noble Eightfold Path: right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Whatever your beliefs are, the middle path is the most important way to ensure that your truth becomes your compass. And that leads to the third step, which is inner freedom. Knowing that freedom is as much internal as it is external. In 1946, around about the same time that George Orwell wrote 1984, Viktor Frankl wrote a book which was called Man's Search for Meaning. That book went on to sell over 12 million copies. I highly recommend you get this book if you haven't read it yet. The story is about how he survived the Nazi concentration camps while seeing his family annihilated, and how he was able to get through that was by realizing there was an indestructible part of himself, his spirit, that would never be destructive regardless of what happened to everything else around him. What he learned can be summed up by the quote, "You don't know what you would live for until you know what you'll die for." As Frankl said in his book, everything can be taken from a man but one thing, the last of the human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way. We're living in an increasingly dangerous and meaningless world. And if you fear you're gonna be trapped in either a meaningless prism of control or a meaningless sea of excess, there's a good chance you might fall into one or both. But by finding that space where freedom cannot be taken away, that's how we create our own world of meaning. Maybe it's through thought or meditation or prayer or contemplation, but finding this spot is essential so that the future world you choose to live in is of your own making. As a Rumi quote goes, out beyond ideas of wrongdoing and rightdoing, there is a field. I will meet you there. I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have, please give it a like. I've left links to the books that I've mentioned here so you can go read the ones you're most interested in. And if you'd like to stay updated with the crisis, I'm gonna keep posting a new video every week. So please do subscribe so we can stay in touch. And what do you think about what future we're heading in? Please drop a comment below. I will do my best to get to as many of the comments as possible, and I'd love to hear from you. And you'll find links to other videos that relate to this one that you can watch after you finish here. And I look forward to seeing you on our next episode of Entrepreneur TV.